the bird, Charlie Parker. Charlie? Charlie, welcome back. It's nice having you with us.
Hello, it's good to be back.
There's one thing that he wanted to do. He didn't worry about anything else as long as he could play that horn. He loved that horn. There's no question about it. He probably loved some other things that he did as well. You know what I mean? But he wanted to play that horn.
He had a very magnetic personality. He was irresistible. And he had a presence. When he walked in a room, it wasn't like an ordinary man walking into a room. I've never known a man in my whole life. I didn't know a man then, and I don't know, I haven't met a man since that attracted people to him the way Bird did.
When I first heard Charlie Parker, it was similar to a laser. He impressed me more than anybody to that point. Charlie Parker had a new approach to playing music. We had the music, but we didn't have the, so to say, pyrotechnics.
It was in the year 1934, in April, that my family, six children, my mother moved into the Parker's house. That's when I first met Charlie. We lived upstairs, and he was standing by the banister with knickers on. I remember the knickers, and looking at all of us go up the steps. And his mother was there. And that's when we connected.
The home Rebecca Ruffin and her family moved into was a big old-fashioned frame house on Olive Street in a black section of Kansas City. The 14-year-old boy who eyed her from the banister that day was destined to become one of the most influential figures in 20th century music. Charles Parker Jr. was born August 29, 1920 in Kansas City, Kansas. His father, a Pullman chef and ex-vaudeville hoofer, left home when Charlie was a boy, taking with him Charlie's half-brother John. Shortly afterwards, his mother, Addie, moved the boy across the river to Kansas City, Missouri. An imposing, devoted, hard-working woman, part Negro and part Choctaw Indian, Addie took in the Ruffins as boarders. The two families lived as one until Mrs. Ruffin saw how much attention Charlie was paying her daughter.
Well, we had been going together, and somehow Mama, after I graduated from high school, my mother saw that we were getting very close, so we moved in the year 36. I think it was March. But later on, my oldest sister, she helped me to get out to see Charlie, and he was playing with Lawrence Keys at the Paseo Hall dance bands. So she helped me to get out to see him. And the night of Joe Louis' fight, his first fight, we were sitting on the attic school steps, and I was about to go, and he asked me, he says, you know, Rebecca, if Miss Ruffin knew we were seeing each other, she would kill you. Let's get married. I said, okay. We went down to the courthouse and during the ceremony, Charlie didn't have any rings or nothing. So Miss Parker took her rings off, she gave it to him, and placed them on my finger. That was it.
When Charlie asked his mother to buy him an alto sax at 12, there was little reason to think anything would come of it. The music conservatories in Kansas City did not admit blacks, and his mother could not have afforded the tuition if they had. But nothing could dispel Charlie's obsession with the alto saxophone or with the improvisations and headlong rhythms of jazz.
Kansas City was open, and it was jumping, you know. Well, Joe Turner was wailing. You could walk out of there and go in there and shoot you some craps if you wanted to. You know, next door, the next room, or whatever. You know what I mean? The town was moving, you know. You see, all the cats is there, and all the babes are there. All the gamblers and pimps. Well, you see, you know what that means. What that means, you know. That means musicians are coming there, too, see. So you got a whole mixture going on. You got a lot of stuff going on all the time, and it never did stop. 24 hours a day.
Charlie played in the high school band and at dance halls. He practiced constantly. When he went to the movies, he tried to figure out how the scores were written. He memorized the solos on records and haunted the downtown clubs, standing in doorways to hear the masters.
Now, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Armstrong.
Louis Armstrong, the genius who first demonstrated how expressive and vital a music jazz could be, was in the era before Charlie Parker the most influential of its virtuoso stylists.
Is anyone finer in the state of Carolina? If there is, then you know, show to me, Dinah. The dick's not blazing, love the city's gazing to the eyes of Dinah Lee. Baby, every man, one eye, shake my fine arm, cut my dynamite, change your mind,
Well, he always said that Louis was the master, you know. You know, Louis could take anything and do something with it. And that's what he always loved about Louis.
Charlie absorbed the lessons of many musicians. One of his favorite records was Fletcher Henderson's Stealing Apples, featuring the tenor saxophonist Leon Chu Berry. Charlie was so impressed with Berry's rolling, authoritative sound that he named his son after him. Charlie was only 18 when Leon was born, but he seemed much older. He had committed his life to music, and at a time when the alto sax was dominated by Benny Carter and Johnny Hodges, he was fortunate to find a hometown master of the instrument who took him under his wing, Buster Smith.
Bird worked with Buster, you know. He worked with Buster's group, and really that was Bird's man, you know. Bird, I remember I heard a broadcast one night during the time that Bird was working with Prof. And so I told Prof, I said, Prof, I said, you sure did sound good last night. He says, what do you mean sound good last night? He says, I didn't play last night. He says, she didn't come up on that bird, and I quit. He said, that was Charlie Parker you heard last night. I said, what? And it sounded just like, you know what I mean, to me, it sounded so much like the Prof, you know, we call Buster Smith Prof.
There were quite a number of other alto players that Bird admired. I mean, people you wouldn't expect, like Jimmy Dorsey, and of course Johnny Hodges, which you did expect.
He always talked about Jimmy Dorsey, And he always mentioned about certain things that Jimmy Dorsey played, you know. And he would do this when he would... it's about the time he might be swinging like crazy and going to Jimmy Dorsey's theme song. And it's still swung.
Still, Charlie seemed less responsive to the other altoists than to the major innovators of tenor sax, all of whom appeared in the Kansas City area. It was Ben Webster who later offered him a job in New York. The already legendary Coleman Hawkins. And especially the star of the Count Basie Orchestra, Lester Young.
Oh, he loved Lester. No question, he had a great impact on the Bird because we would set our breaks when we find out the bass is going to broadcast. We'd set our breaks along with the broadcast. Then we'd run out in the car and listen to the broadcast, and he definitely wanted to hear Lester, you know. That was his main purpose, Bird. When you sort of speaking of Basie, you see, that's just putting Bird right on at home, you know, because, see, you know, Bird loves that Basie sound, you know, and then Bird loved swing, you see. He loved to swing because he loved to pat his foot. He loved to see people patting their foot. He loved to see people moving. Charlie took frequent jobs in the Ozarks, 150 miles away. On Thanksgiving of 1936, the band's speeding car skidded on ice and overturned. One man was killed. Charlie broke 3 ribs and fractured his spine. After he recovered, Rebecca noticed changes.
About July of 37, he called me upstairs. And he says, go sit around that side of the bed. I thought he had something for me. I looked in the mirror and I saw him stick this needle in his arm, and I screamed, and I got up and I said, why? And he just smiled, and he his tie was the tourniquet, and I was watching. Then it came into my mind that on the dresser I'd seen so many other ties in small ties. But that was all. He didn't say anything. He just wiped his arm and put the tie around him under his collar, put his jacket on, and come over and kiss me on the forehead. And he said, see you in the morning.
Jay McShann arrived in Kansas City broke, but determined to organize a band of his own. By 1939, he had recruited the city's best young musicians for an outstanding orchestra with a penchant for the blues. Charlie was a major asset as a dazzling soloist and an able section man. While traveling with McShann, Charlie was to acquire a permanent nickname.
Well, we used to go up there and play
love to fraternities, you know, sororities in Lincoln. And this particular day we were going up and we were driving up. We had automobile, you know, I think we had about three or four cars. And in the car that Bird was riding in, they, you know, I'd be driving along the highway, just two lanes, one going and one coming, you know. And when you pass through these little settlements, the farmer's chickens would run all out on the highway, right outside of the car, you know. And so they hit one of the chickens, you know. And so Bird said, "Hey, man, did you know you hit that yard bird back there?" So the driver says, "Well, what about it?" He said, "Man, stop this car and back up. Let's pick up to the yard bird." So they did. They stopped. Well, the guy backed up and picked up the yard bird. Bird took it on into Lincoln. And during those times, you know, we stayed at people's houses, you know. And at the lady's house where he stayed, he took it in and asked her. He said, "Miss, we hit this yard bird coming up here. Would you cook this yard bird for me?" She said, "Sure." And so Bird had him a feast.
Musicians now called him Yard Bird, or Yard, or Bird. And the name seemed to act as an impetus. Living on the road, he had little time for his family, and Kansas City was no longer a hotbed for music. He yearned to flee the Midwest and make his name in New York. His departure was inevitable.
He came to me. He says, "I'd like to have a talk with you, Rebecca." So we went into the dining room, and we both sit there, and he held my hand, and he says, "Rebecca, would you free me, please?" And I just looked at him. He says, "I believe I could become a great musician if I were free." I never said a word. It's just something, you know. So he called his mother. He says, "Ma, would you come in here, please?" And she said, "What is it, Charlie?" And he says, Rebecca is going to free me. And I want you to make a promise to me that for as long as she and Leon live, they'll have a roof over their head, food in their mouth." And that's all. Or he would never be back.
Charlie pawned his horn, stole a ride on a freight train bound for Chicago, and made his way to New York.
Hurry to get to New York. He loved New York. You know, no question about it. He always talked about, even when we had the small band, that he wanted to get back to New York. In fact, about it, during the time when we had the small band, he left the band for about a year and was gone and came to New York. And because when he came back to Kansas City, he was telling about how he stood on the corner and he looked up there at the sign at the said Savoy Ballroom and looked and so he just stood there and dreamed.
There was little work for an unknown musician, but Charlie washed dishes for 3 months at $9 a week just to hear the awesome pianist at Jimmy's Chicken Shack, Art Tatum. In 1941, Charlie finally played the Savoy Ballroom with Jay McShann's band. They were a hit. Despite his personal unpredictability, Charlie's music had begun to display a fierce originality. His solos on Cherokee amazed musicians. Some of them, including Dizzy Gillespie, had formed a clique in the Earl Hines band, and they encouraged Hines to hire Bird.
So Earl Hines told me, "Said, now look, Magnus, now if Bird owe you any money, you better let me know." He said, "Because I got the money to pay if he owes you." He says, "Because now," he says, "now I want him, I'm going to get him anyway." He said, "I'm going to get him." He said, "Because I got the money to get him." I said, "Well, okay." This guy says, "Listen, he owed me so and so and so and so and so and so." So Earl signed the paper. Earl paid me off. He says, "Can he go now?" I says, "Yes." So Bird went on with Hines' band. So he was We're at Hines Bend, so I didn't see the cats. Hines, a bird, and them, none of them, for about 3.5 full months. So when I saw them again, I think we were down at Kelly Stables on 52nd Street. And Earl Hines come up to me. He says, listen. He says, come back. He says, look, man, come get this Charlie Parker. He says, because that is the worst guy in the world. I said, but you told me you were going to make a man out of him. He said, no, look. He said, he owes everybody in town, owes everybody in the band. He says, I don't know where the horn is.
One of the first times that I really was impressed by the Earl Hines Orchestra was on a Friday night at the Apollo Theater. It was its opening night there. And Sarah Vaughan, who had just joined him, it was her first real professional night as a musician, came out and sang Body and Soul. I wrote about it in a metronome and said that she showed a remarkable harmonic sense or something. And that was just when the beboppers were beginning to infiltrate the band.
New York is the place, and both of us blossomed after our meeting. And then it was solidified by the idea that I went with Earl Hines. At the same time he did, because he was playing tenor at the time, but his music was still the same. So we got together there, and we played with Billy Eckstine.
I love the rhythm in the rip. When the music comes, I get lift. Body, little, anything to make it swing. I love the muted trumpet tone, blend with the mellow saxophone. What a lot of kicks it brings. When that rhythm's in ya, the blues don't have a chance. Find that groove when ya, make you never think about romance. Jump, jump your rhythm with the riff. Any kind of music, it's a lift. Body, anything to make it swing.
Billy Eckstine was one of the best band leaders. Probably the best that I had to work for. He understood the music. He was a supporter of the music. Supporter of your inventing. He was just a beautiful man.
Charlie Parker's apprenticeship with Hines and Eckstine was not recorded because of a strike that halted the production of records for 2 years. Yet it was during that time that the seeds of modern jazz or bebop blossomed. The after-hour jam sessions at a Harlem club called Mittens encouraged an appetite for new harmonies, melodies, and rhythms. The house band included two major contributors to modern jazz. The pianist and composer Thelonious Monk was celebrated for his total originality and subtle humor. Drummer Kenny Clarke created surprising rhythmic accents that were often cited as the origin of the rhythmic word bebop. By 1945, a generation of modernists was in place, including three of Parker's most steadfast collaborators. Drummer Max Roach, famed for his glittering touch and melodic solos. Pianist Bud Powell, a virtuoso who constantly plumbed the deepest wellsprings of emotion. And trumpeter Miles Davis, the most lyrical of the modernists and subsequently a major innovator in his own right. The nucleus for jazz in New York was not Harlem, but 52nd Street, where a block-long bazaar of nightclubs offered an extravagant banquet of talent. There was much resistance to the new jazz, but when Parker and Gillespie opened at the Three Deuces in 1945, the fast kinetic ensemble themes and flaring solos seemed to speak out for a generation that had just lived through the most barbaric war in history.
What is a club here, club here, club here, club here, and then the White Rose here, and then another couple of clubs up here on the 2nd Street. So between sets, it would be a big deal. Everybody's going to different places, you know, to hear the other guys that were on the street at the time.
It was a strange mixture because one side of the street you had Jimmy Ryan's where all the Dixielanders went, and on the other side you would have maybe Jack Teagarden in one place, Art Tatum in another, Billie Holiday, Colin Hawkins, all these incredible people. And that was also the White Rose Bar, which was on the corner of 52nd and 6th Avenue, where you would go between sets and meet with the other musicians. And I remember one night Ben Webster was telling me about this fantastic Alder play. I think it was really the first time I was introduced to Charlie Parker.
I heard about Bird before I heard him. There was a band, I believe it was at the Onyx, with Don Byas and Dizzy. And Don was leaving the band, and I thought Don was just the end. I loved Don's music. And I knew the press agent at the club and asked who they could possibly get to replace Don Byas. And they said, oh, there's a cat in Kansas City. You don't know him. His name's Charlie Parker. And I said, is he cute? And my friend said, no, but you'll dig him. But Bird never made that gig. And then when he did come, he opened at the Deuces with Dizzy. That was the first time I heard him. His sound was so different because I was used to Johnny Hodges and Benny Carter. And his sound took me a minute to get used to, but I knew what he was playing was something just incredible. The street during that era, it was during World War II, and there were a lot of servicemen on the street, a lot of servicemen from the South who had never seen a racially mixed couple. There were a lot of problems with that.
One of the things that was happening back in that period, the initial period of the bebop, they would take a composition and make a different melody of it, like say, like, what is this thing called love? And they would make a different melody, a different line that they would use. They wouldn't play the melody like, what is this thing called love? They would play a sort of a bebop line to it, as we would call it, a line. A melody, the out chorus, and on the same chords, and maybe change a few of the chords and the structure of the tone.
Bird first recorded as a leader in November of 1945 with Dizzy, Max Roach, and Miles Davis. The masterpiece of the session was based on Charlie's specialty number, Cherokee. Tenor saxophonist and band leader Charlie Barnett had made the tune a popular hit despite its difficult chords. Parker's version ignored the song's melody entirely. The result was a culminating performance that encompassed everything Parker had learned. It was an inspired, thrilling assault on musical conventions, and he called his line Coco. Thank you. 2 weeks after the Coco session, Bird and Dizzy made a fateful visit to Los Angeles. For Charlie, the trip lasted 2 years and proved almost fatal.
Well, we had an 8-week job out there, and it was very new music. California was a long ways off, and they were behind and evolution. Only the guys from New York that were out there that knew what was happening, you know, with the new music.
Bird had his triumphs in L.A., Yardbird Suite, A Night in Tunisia, Ornithology, and more. But he was coming apart at the seams, drinking heavily and overindulging his addiction.
During that time, heroin was the thing. And if Bird got high, all musicians and fans figured that was the thing to do. That's how much people lied to lie to them, and they would do it just because Charlie Parker did it.
When Charlie Parker used drugs, it seemed to be almost socially acceptable as far as the people in and around music. I thought the heroin and the bebop and the whole lifestyle, they went together. I felt that one had to use heroin to play like Charlie Parker played.
The Love Man session, I call it the most catastrophic recording session in history. Bird came in late, everybody was really late, but Bird hadn't made his connection. And he was trying to make a session without his medicine, I put it like that. Now, I can't put them in chronological order how it went down, but we did, we did bebop, Max making wax, and he scuffled through those. In fact, he scuffled through all of them. Lover Man and the Gypsy. But by the time we got to the Gypsy, he was so out of it. The man was ill. He just couldn't go any farther. Now, I've been on the stand with him before where he had to leave the stand to be so low. You understand what I'm saying? Like at the Heidi Hole Club, a different club. This was a recording session. Then Howard had to finish the session out, so they had to take him out of there, take him home, you know. And that's the reason I call it the most catastrophic session, because what he played on those tunes, Bird was real ill. But if you listen to Lover Man, nothing but soul.
I don't think anybody was particularly aware of exactly when he came home. There was certainly no welcome home celebration. He just reappeared on the scene and was very clean for quite a while. And actually, I saw a side of Charlie Parker, fortunately, more often than not, when he was straight. And when he was straight, he was very good, very normal, happy company. I mean, we went out to the beach together with my wife and my mother-in-law and my little daughter, and he would go out there and we'd eat hot dogs and walk along the beach, and it was just like, you know, your next door neighbor. There was that side to Charlie which not everybody saw.
He had a great sense of caring. I was with Earl Hines, Chief Beard, and I both were with him. And intermission, I was sitting up playing the piano, right? This is a good example. And then some white guy threw a couple pennies up on the stage. I looked down at the pennies and the winds kept playing. Well, that night after the dance, and I thought everybody had left, it was a white dance, I went to the toilet. And when I came out of the toilet, I just happened to look around like this, and this guy had a bottle, and he hit me up here. This bottle and the blood came all out of my uniform. And I picked up a, I don't know, it was one of those big beer bottles. I was on the crown, this guy, and a lot of guys grabbed me. And Charlie Parker came in to sell all this blood. He told the guy, he said, "You took advantage of my friend, you cur." Call him a cur. First time I'd heard that.
One day my doorbell on 52nd Street rang. I was living with Kim and my mother. And this woman downstairs said, "There's a man here on a horse to see you." Well, I knew it could only be Bird. So I went down and there was Bird on a palomino. And he'd come to show the horse to Kim. But the reason he did that was because he had great respect for my father, whom he'd never met. He had a club at one time, and he'd have the orchestra come to Westchester after work to play under my window, "Why Do I Love You?" And Bird was just emulating my father. He didn't have a band to bring, and so he brought the horse. He wanted to do something that Kim would remember the way I remembered my father bringing the band.
The late 40s were the glory years of bebop, as modern jazz was popularly known. The key innovators began to align the new music to their separate musical interest. Dizzy Gillespie suggested things to come when he formed a big band. Charlie Parker's preferred instrumentation remained, for the time being, his quintet: alto, sax, trumpet, piano, bass, and drums. Parker received little attention from the general public. His fame among musicians was worldwide. His style was endlessly analyzed and imitated. You couldn't play in the modern jazz idiom without acknowledging a debt to Bird. In 1949, he made his first of two successful European tours. In Paris especially, he realized that he could achieve the kind of respect that was reserved for classical musicians at home. By then, his reputation was such that fans and musicians followed him with recording devices to preserve every solo, every glimmer of a musical idea.
He felt very, very proud and very honored, and he was treated so differently over there. He came back with gifts and records that people had given him, and he wanted to move there. He really, I think that was his greatest triumph, the two European tours.
The trip abroad also strengthened his resolve to expand the context of his music. With the help of producer Norman Granz, he organized an ensemble of strings for touring and recording. The strings reflected his long-standing passion for modern classical music. He hoped to study composition with Edgar Varèse, but there wouldn't be time for that. Instead, he recorded pop songs, including the masterful Just Friends.
Bird told me that when he was traveling with the string section, that he was on his best behavior. He showed up on time, he dressed well, he kept his drug use to a minimum. He practiced hard every day. He said he felt like he was being presented, he was being showcased properly. It was a very big, deep hurt to Bird when they took the strings. That's the way he said it, when they took the strings away from me.
Parker was caught in a tailspin. He was trying to cut down on drugs and making it up with wine. He was erratic, often late, and sometimes absent from jobs. One night after an argument, he was banned from Birdland, the famous jazz club named in his honor. Yet Bird could still play with great brilliance. On a Sunday evening in 1952, Bird and Dizzy performed on the television show Stage Entrance, a show business omnibus with newspaper columnist Earl Wilson.
Well, you know, Bird always felt that that prejudice coming through that Earl definitely shows on the tape. Somehow he got through it with gritted teeth, but I love the expressions on the video where, I mean, that's a definite put down. Bird could kill with a look, you know.
And here he is, Mr. Leonard Feather. Come on, Leonard, my boy. Yeah. Leonard Feather here. This is quite an occasion, isn't it? Listen, what do I do about this? Do I say, give me five or give me some scanners? That stuff out of date.
Well, that changes so fast, I'll have to look at my next issue of Zombie to find out about it.
Anyway, you got the awards, and it's
right.
Really quite an event.
Well, it's quite an event in two senses, actually, Earl, because, you know, in the music business, we've been practicing brotherhood for quite a long time. Man's color and his religion don't make any difference. When you put a horn in his hands, the only thing that counts is his talent.
Well, I think that's the thing about the Down Beach All-American Band. It makes it All-American because it's of different creeds and different races.
I believe that's right.
Well, how about it? How are we going to get rid of these now?
Well, I've been used to doing this for quite a while. Maybe it'd be a nice change if I turn it over to you, let you do the honors.
Well, I'd love to.
Okay, well, Charlie, Dizzy?
Well, here they are.
Hello,
this
girl.
Is Charlie Parker and...
Thank you.
The famous Dizzy Gillespie. Now, fellas, Leonard says I'm supposed to be the Toastmaster, the sort of the Georgie Jessel of jazz. So, Charlie, I want to award you now the Downbeat Award for the best alto sax man of 1951.
Thank
Congratulations
you,
to you.
Thank you.
And, Diz, this is to you from Downbeat for being one of the top trumpet men of all time.
Thank you.
Congratulations, Diz. I mean, Dizzy, I got a little informal there. You boys got anything more to say?
Well, Earl, they say music speaks louder than words, so we'd rather voice our opinion that way, if you don't mind.
I think that'd be all right with everybody, if you really want to do it.
Good.
Okay, now, while you fellows are getting us up there, I better tell the public that we're going to have some really torrid tempo with Charlie Parker, the alto sax, and Diz at the trumpet, and Dick Hyman's at the piano. They're going to play, what is it?
I think it's Hot House.
Hot House? Okay, fellas, let's go.
another aspect of the bebop thing that was so hurtful and so upsetting to the musicians was that people treated it as a joke. You know, these write-ups in Time magazine and Life and so forth, all they concentrated on was Dizzy's beret and the horn-rimmed glasses and the goatees and everything but the music itself. There was no serious attention paid to Charlie Parker as a great creative musician in the general national press, in the newspapers, in the magazines, on radio, on television, any of the media. It was just horrifying how really miserably he was treated. And this goes for the way Dizzy Gillespie is treating everybody.
I dig it, you ain't hip, old man, to Easy Pop Pop in its own pan.
You mean Easy Pop Pop in its own pan?
Now you're swinging, Daddy, crazy man. Why don't you make it with me to the grocery shop? We'll both dig a pan of this Easy Pop. The pop pop do the apple do did me. The pop do art. Easy Pop, man, that's real popcorn.
Here's Anthropology.
Bird, he was a very different type of a person. I always enjoyed playing with him and being around him. Some nights he would come in and the club would be crowded. He'd just come in and play his heart out and burn. You could see something happen and play about it on his instrument. Like he'd see a pretty girl walk in the club we're playing. He'd be playing a solo, and all of a sudden he'd go into, a pretty girl is like a melody, wherever he was, and make it fit in. Or somebody was acting a little Lukey Tooney, he'd play something to fit that. You know, fast. Fast mind. Genius mind. And it would fit. Yeah, I know sometimes he'd be playing a solo and he'd be playing a certain part of The Last Time I Saw Paris. And he'd keep playing in different keys. Da-da-da-da-da-da-da, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, you know. And he's burning. Then at the end I said, Bird, what did happen the last time you saw Paris?
Charlie had two children with Chan in addition to her daughter, Kim, a boy, Baird, and a girl, Pri. In March 1954, while working in California, he learned that Pri, not yet 3 years old, died of a congestive heart condition. He broke. Eventually, Charlie separated from Chan and stayed with friends in Greenwich Village. But first, he made peace with a part of his past.
The last time I saw him was 54, when he brought Chan to the house. Early one morning, he ushered me into the kitchen. I hadn't looked at him then. And we were looking out the kitchen window. And he had his hand over mine like that. He says, if I had my life to live over, this is what I would want. He says, please forgive me. And that's when I looked up at him and I says, oh my God, he's dying.
Parker was reduced to playing in dives that were little more than empty storefronts. Drinking cheap red wine, he exacerbated his stomach ulcers. That was a suicide attempt. On March 9th, 1955, a year after the death of his daughter, Charlie visited his friend, the Baroness Panonica de Koenigswater, an ardent jazz enthusiast who lived at the Stanhope Hotel. 3 days later, he died in her living room while watching the Tommy Dorsey Show on television. The medical examiner estimated his age at 55 to 60 and attributed death to lobar pneumonia. Charlie Parker was 34 years old.
When I first heard that Charlie Parker had died, I was on the bandstand at the California Club on a Monday night in Los Angeles. We took advantage of the fact that Bird had died to announce to the people that we were going to take an extra long intermission. We proceeded to go celebrate Bird's death by doing the very thing that killed him. This is the way we celebrated Bird's passing, was to go out and use some junk. You know, all of us. I think it would have been better if we had realized that it was time to stop.
Well, I didn't have a marriage certificate. And he had been taken to the funeral home where our daughter, who had died a year before, had been. And we also had a two-grave plot in the cemetery where she was buried. And I knew that Bird didn't want to go to Kansas City, and that he would have wanted to have been buried next to our daughter. And not having a marriage certificate, I didn't have any control. And he was taken out of the funeral home. He was taken to Harlem. His suit was changed. He was put in a pinstripe suit. A crucifix was hung over his coffin. Bird was irreligious. And he was taken to Kansas City, and he was buried from Adam Clayton Powell's church and by the Reverend Licorice, who the music was the Lost Chord, and all the people who had taken advantage of him financially and business-wise during his life were the pallbearers. And it was really a travesty, to use one of Bird's favorite words.
And we're going to bury him out here, up here in New York someplace. So I was thinking, I said, well, man, I don't think that's right, you know, because his mother has been down there all this time, you know, and look like she should have the pleasure of going out to the gravesite and putting flowers on the grave and everything like that. We had a close, a spiritual relationship. Walk up and kiss me in my mouth. You know what I'm saying? We love one another, you know.
Charlie Parker's greatest triumph was what he did for jazz. What he did for jazz, what he did for music. He changed the whole complete scene. As we said a while ago, he was definitely a stylist. Everybody went that way. Piano players, trombone players, trumpet players, saxophone players.
The triumph of Charlie Parker means to me that Bird lives. Believe me, he lives. His music lives. The triumph of Charlie Parker, is valid. It's here.
Charlie Parker once said, "Music is your own experience, your thoughts, your wisdom. If you don't live it, it won't come out of your horn."
About this new recording that you just made, Leapfrog. Is that the old Leapfrog that Les Brown made, or is it...
No, it's another thing altogether. It's an original, something of mine that Norman Grant decided he wanted to call Leapfrog.
And the other side you call Relaxing with Lee. Who's Lee?
I don't have the slightest idea. They named those tunes after I leave the studio.
They name it after... Could be Lee Konitz, it could be Lee, somebody, I don't know. Yeah. You know, I only did this, really, Bird, because you have such a wonderful speaking voice, and not everybody gets a chance to hear you. And I thought that, You know, just getting you to talk a little bit would make everybody feel fine. Your original... Where is your home, by the way?
Kansas City.
I was going to say that. We reach that far.
You do?
Uh-huh.
There's a chance friends of mine in my hometown are listening.
I wonder if there's a friend in Kansas City this morning who is listening to Charlie Parker and Strings. I wonder what they called Bob Garrity in the snake pit over there at Jetson 65454. Who do you think might be listening this morning?
I don't know. I have a lot of friends in Kansas City.
You have
anybody
a lot of...
Could be listening?
You do have a lot of friends in Kansas City.
Yeah.
Well, just for kicks, we have stopped taking requests, you know. But just for kicks, it would be real wonderful if somebody from Kansas City... Hey, Garrity, you may get a call from Kansas City. If you do, would you sort of rush it out?